everyone, it's Bretta Riches from runforfoot.com. And I've had a lot of conversation in my previous videos on running related chronic exertional compartment syndrome, which is a chronic intense lower leg pain that occurs during running and progressively gets worse as you run. In this video, I just want to revisit more research on the painful condition and how heel strike running certainly plays a huge role in causing chronic exertional compartmental syndrome. And that if you continue to run with a heel strike running style, doing so will not bring any resolve to the painful leg condition. Luckily, the smart move to make to treat the condition and avoid surgery is with forefoot running. And I will talk about how chronic exertional compartmental syndrome can be rooted out by forefoot running. Ultimately, chronic exertional compartmental syndrome of the lower leg is a big obstacle for a runner because the deep radiating pain pierces up and down the leg, making it increasingly difficult to maintain running, in which the throbbing radiating leg pain most often intensifies as running continues. A 2011 study published in the International Journal of Sports and Physical Therapy, which I will link the study below, the study unsurprisingly points to heel strike running as the facilitator and enabler for causing chronic exertional compartmental syndrome because there is certain mechanical components or constraints of heel strike running that may prevent a runner from running pain-free in the lower leg. The mechanical constraint is called ankle dorsiflexion at touchdown. What that means is that before the heel strikes the ground in heel strike running, the forefoot and the toes, or the front part of the foot, is pulled back so that the heel can make initial contact on the ground. The action of ankle dorsiflexion to enable heel strike winds the front part of the foot back, creating a lot of tension in the ankle and along the top of the shin. At a certain point during a heel strike landing pattern, the forefoot is released and slaps down on the ground with intensive force. This slapping is a key driving force for chronic exertional compartmental syndrome. As soon as the forefoot slaps down on the ground right after heel strike, the foot rolls through and over the arch and onto the forefoot and the toes, which the forefoot and the toes are now used to help launch and propel the entire body forward to initiate the flight phase of running. But the core problem in causing throbbing lower leg pain is rooted in the forefoot slapping that occurs after the heel struck the ground. And to reiterate, the forefoot slapping is created and caused by ankle dorsiflexion at touchdown. So remember, ankle dorsiflexion is the action of pulling the forefoot back to allow the foot to heel strike or strike the ground heel first. As part of the slapping of the forefoot also accompanies a jolting force and a break in forward momentum that achieves a kind of penetration that causes intramuscular pressure within the lower leg to accumulate at a rapid rate in the lower leg, which potentially finances the pain associated with chronic exertional compartmental syndrome. Furthermore, the current study also found that the constant forefoot lifting and slapping that occurs at each step in heel strike running causes the tibialis anterior, or the front part of the shin, causes the shin bone, if you will, to deaccelerate the front part of the foot at each step, which elevates lower leg compartmental pressures. Basically, what all this means is that heel strike running sends a lot of the mechanical work to the shins in order to lift the forefoot back to allow a clear heel strike. The slapping of the forefoot after the heel has struck the ground in heel strike running causes the shins to do additional work at pulling the forefoot back or lifting the forefoot up, which a 2005 study published in the International Journal of Sports and Medicine found that when the shin pulled the forefoot back in heel strike running, this increased intramuscular activation in the front of the lower leg, which promoted greater anterior compartmental pressure during running. Therefore, there is a very bright line with high confidence linking heel strike running to chronic exertional compartmental syndrome. But what about wearing running shoes with more cushioning? Added cushioning is not always sufficient and is not always necessary because it's the mechanics. Running in cushion-heeled running shoes can be considered a bad practice for treating chronic exertional compartmental syndrome, because running shoes, like cushion-heeled running shoes, actually cause runners to strike the ground harder on their heels. So most running shoes on the market are heel strike enablers, which add to the fiercely debated question, are cushioned traditional running shoes practical for treating some running related injuries? Well, not really, because most running shoes directly fund heel strike running and provoke a harmful heel strike landing pattern during running simply because of how the foot is specifically positioned in cushion-heeled running shoes. It's best to run in footwear that tips the balance away from heel striking during running and helps you land more on the front part of your foot or your forefoot. Likewise, if we have learned anything from the core cause of chronic exertional compartmental syndrome, is that you may need to convert your heel strike landing pattern to a forefoot strike landing pattern, and you cannot substitute with greater underfoot cushioning from a running shoe. As part of the process, you may need to give up your shoe cushioning and try running barefoot or running in running shoes that are flatter and more barefoot-like, barefoot feeling, because these shoes play into forefoot running, as minimalistic shoes will make your forefoot strike easier to navigate when you can actually feel where and how you are stepping on your foot when you run. Overall, progress may not happen if you continue to lift and slap your forefoot with your heel strike running style. You may need to have greater focus on learning forefoot running, which, according to the studies that I just briefly mentioned, has quite a record of success in the area of actually curing chronic exertional compartmental syndrome. Your priority should be avoid lifting your forefoot when you run, when your foot strikes the ground. Now, I must mention, some elite distance runners do lift their forefoot back to some degree. Examples of some forefoot lifters are Mo Farah, sometimes Kennedy Sabakili, but the degree of their forefoot lifting actually depends on their footwear, because when these two runners in particular wear cushion-heeled running shoes for road running, these specific runners tend to slightly raise their forefoot back, more so than if they wore racing flats on the track. Nonetheless, let us remember, most professional distance runners are typically forefoot runners who typically don't really lift their forefoot back when their foot strikes the ground when they run. In that regard, most elite distance runners are not heel striking prominently like most joggers. While some elite runners like Mo Farah may lift their forefoot before their foot strikes the ground, they do so with less intensive efforts, with less ankle dorsiflexion duration. And to be clear, most of these elite distance runners, like Kennedy Sabakili, strike the ground ahead of their heel during running, and not directly on their heel at touchdown during running, whereas most joggers land prominently heel first with a longer ankle dorsiflexion duration, since they are landing point blank directly on their heel. With that, their forefoot is raised higher off the ground at touchdown with, again, an extended duration of ankle dorsiflexion, causing the forefoot to slap harder on the ground, and the shins carry much of the energetic and mechanical burden in pulling the forefoot back at each step in heel strike running. I just wanted to touch on that. And getting back to treating chronic exertional compartmental syndrome, most therapeutic approaches have been more focused at stuffing more cushioning under the foot in hopes to reduce impact during running than countering or fixing the mechanical problems that drive lower leg pain. Really, much of the underlying causes of chronic exertional compartmental syndrome hinges on how you position your forefoot when your foot strikes the ground during running. This raises the confidence of using forefoot running to contribute to a more effective fight in completely ridding and avoiding chronic exertional compartmental syndrome. In that regard, your strategy should include two main elements during running. Number one, land on your forefoot. And number two, don't lift your forefoot back upon and at touchdown when you run, which brings along relaxation at the shins. And by doing these two key mechanical components when forefoot running, breaks and dismantles the harmful pipeline that facilitates the flow of accumulating intramuscular lower leg pressures. This is just one of the many ways you can score victories with forefoot running, because forefoot running releases a lot of tension in the front of the shin, giving new leverage in terms of saving energy. And again, you don't want to wear running shoes that goes against or interferes with your forefoot strike landing pattern or causes you to drift away from your forefoot strike landing pattern, which is why minimalist running shoes are always helpful for you to acquire much better motor coordination because you have better ground feel. Barefoot running is an even better target intervention for maximizing ground feel because there's no ground feel distortion. It's more capable of causing profound improvements in mechanics that is more effective at making your forefoot strike more adaptable. Anyways, you know that I just can't end a video without talking about the value of running barefoot. Aside from that, I will also link below a video on the demonstration of a proper forefoot strike landing pattern. For more information on the health benefits of forefoot running, please visit my blog, runforfoot.com, and please subscribe to my YouTube channel to stay updated on all the latest research on the biomechanics of running. Thank you so much for listening and watching. Have fun out there on the roads. Bye for now.